Hello students, welcome back to Business Studies class, Chapter 3, Business Environment. So in the last session, we have dealt the meaning of business environment, the features of business environment, the importance of business environment, and the dimensions, some of the dimensions of business environment. That is the economic environment, the social environment, and the technological environment. Now, the remaining forces or the environment which is affecting the performance of business enterprises, they are the political environment and the legal environment. Now, what is political environment? The environment, the political condition. So, the political environment includes the political conditions. The political conditions in a country, that is the general stability and the peace in the country, the general stability, the political stability and the peace maintained in the country, and the specific attitude that elected government representative have towards the business. So, what is the attitude of the political parties, the elected government representative towards the business? All these are very important. They have some effect on the performance of the business. So, political environment includes the political conditions that which includes conditions such as the general stability of the political party, the peace in the country, and the specific attitude that these political parties or the elected representative hold towards business. So this is very much important, and the significance of political conditions, what is the importance, significance of political condition in business success, lies in the predictability of the business activities. So if there is a stable political condition, if there is a stable political condition in a country, we can predict the business activity. So the significance of political condition in business success lies in the predictability of business activities which is under stable political condition. So it means if there is political stability, we can predict the business activities. So the success lies there. On the other hand, there may be uncertainty if there is political unrest and threats to law and order. Every now and then, if there is a change in the political system, the political condition, then this may prove as a threat to the law and order, and because of this political unrest, we are not able to predict the business activities. It may result in uncertainty of business activities because of political unrest and threat to law and order. So simply we can say political stability builds confidence. Political stability builds confidence among the business people to invest in long term, projects. So they will have a confidence that this is a stable government, we can invest more and think about, we can easily predict the business activities, we can have long term projects. That is only if there is political stability. If there is political instability, then it will shake the confidence. It will shake the confidence of the business. So, political instability can shake that confidence. Political stability builds confidence. so the business people can think of investing in long-term projects. Why? There may not be any much change in the near coming future regarding the industrial policies, or any now new industrial policies may not come, because the government is stable for a long period, long tenure. It has got a long tenure. In case if there is political instability, it will shake the confidence. There is uncertainty. You cannot think of investing in long-term projects. So this attitude of government officials towards business also. Likewise, the attitude of the elected government officials, elected government representatives also, will have a negative, positive or a negative impact upon the business. So the government officials who are indirectly they pro a threat, or they may be your opportunity, they will have a positive or a negative impact on the business. For example, even after the 1991 new industrial policy, opening up of the economy, we'll be studying it later, opening up of the economy because of the financial crisis which the Indian economy faced in 1991, many foreign companies found it difficult to cut through the bureaucratic red tape to get permit for their business in India. Even after opening up the economy, even after opening up our economy, liberalization, privatization, globalization, some foreign companies found difficult to cut the bureaucratic red tape which was found in many of the business because of this political involvement. So they found difficult to get the permission or the license to carry on the business. Sometimes it took months together to process their application for the purpose. So these foreign companies or these foreign investors were discouraged from entering into or investing in the countries, investing in our country. Even though there was globalization, even though after 1991, the new industrial policy, economy was open up, because of few government representatives' attitudes, they found it difficult to cut through the bureaucratic red tape and get permission, in getting the permission, licensing for carrying on their business. Their application, for processing of the application, took months together, and this discouraged the foreign companies in investing in our country. Later on, it was able to improve. Later on, the situation improved. So the situation improved over time. So how the political environment has an impact indirectly? Mainly because of the involvement of the government representatives, the elected government officials. So general, it includes the political conditions factors are general stability and peace in the country. Sometimes this riots, communalism, riots, strikes, they're also, these business enterprises will face huge loss. If there is they call for Bharat Band. The small business or the any business enterprises for that matter, one particular day if it is band or you have seen this lockdown, there will be huge loss to the business enterprises. So the peace in the country and the specific attitude that elected representatives hold towards the business, though that is political environment. So this political environment, the significance of the political condition in business lies on the stability. If there is stability, then you can predict the business activities. So political stability builds confidence. The business people can think of investing in long-term projects. If there is political instability, it will shake the confidence and it will hamper the growth of the business and industry. And even after opening up the economy, there were the foreign companies found difficult to cut through the bureaucratic red tape for permitting, for getting license to carry on their business. It took months together for processing of their application, and this encouraged the foreigners to invest in our country. Later on, over the time, this situation improved. So that is political environment. Now next, coming to legal environment. What is it? Legal environment includes various legislations passed by government administrative orders issued by government authorities. So legislations passed by government administrative orders, which is issued by government authorities, court judgments, and some decisions taken up by various commissions and agencies. So these are the legal, these are included in legal environment. So what is legal environment? Legal environment includes, legal comes from legislation word, various legislations passed by the government administrative orders, which is issued by government authorities. Not only government authorities, it can be by the court's judgment, and also decisions taken or rendered by various commissions and agencies. Now what are these? Here each commissions and agents at any level, it may be central, it may be state or local, so it is the, every management has to obey these legislations, rules, acts or regulations, we say. So there should be, every business enterprises should have an adequate knowledge of these rules and regulations framed by the government. It is a prerequisite for better business performance. So every business enterprise, a businessman or a manager, should have adequate knowledge of the rules and the regulations framed, because this proves as a prerequisite for carrying on better, for the better business performances. If there is non-compliance, if the business enterprises, they have to obey these rules and regulations, if they do not obey, go against, or non-compliance of these laws can land the business into legal problems. So if they are not carrying on their business according to the laws, regulations, legislation passed, then they will get into, they will land into legal problems. So in India, a working knowledge of, every business enterprises should have a working knowledge of the Companies Act, earlier it was 1956, now 2013. Every working in India, a working knowledge of, all business enterprises should have a working knowledge of Companies Act 1956, now 2013. Then you have the Industries Development and Regulation Act of 1951, Foreign Exchange and Import Export Act of 1947, Factories Act 1948, Consumer Protection Act 1986, then Competition Act 2002, and such other legal enactments have been done from time to time, which is important for doing business. So every business enterprises need to have a working knowledge of all these acts, Companies Act of 1956-2013, Industries Development and Regulation Act 1951, you have Foreign Exchange Management Act and Import Export Act 1947, Workmen's Compensation Act 1923, Factories Act 1948, Trade Union Act 1926, Industrial Dispute Act, in order to bring a cordial relation, in order to settle the dispute, so you should have some idea about that, 1947, any compensation to the workers, Workers' Compensation Act 1923, procedures for foreign exchange, forex business, import export business, Foreign Exchange Management and Import Export Act 1947, trade unions, they trade union, every business enterprises have a trade union. They should act accordingly as per the Act 1926. Recent Competition Act, Competition Edge, Competition Act, how within that, how you can have competition, healthy competition, or how is it? 2002, and Consumer Protection Act 1986, you'll have a chapter on that. Consumer protection, what is it? How consumers have to be protected against the exploitation of the big capitalist. Consumers' welfare and interest has to be looked upon. So this Consumer Act, Protection Act was enacted 1986, where you have the consumer's rights, consumer's responsibilities, and you have the consumer forum at three levels. You have three-tier redressal agencies at the district, state and national commission. So this gives an awareness to the consumers regarding their rights, regarding their responsibilities. So they come to know what is it. So all these legislations are passed, and a business enterprises have to know about all this so they can act within the framework of these legislations passed by the government authorities, by the government administrative orders, or it may be through the court judgment, or it may be decisions given by the various commissions and agencies. So here, the impact of legal environment can be illustrated with the help of government regulations towards protecting consumers. An example, here you have the advertisement for alcoholic beverages is prohibited. You don't have any advertisement for alcoholic drinks, alcoholic beverages. So that is in order to protect the consumers. Also, the advertisement regarding the sale of cigarettes, there is a statutory warning given. Every packet of cigarettes should contain that. What is it? Statutory warning. Cigarette smoking is injurious to health. Okay? So they have to, sell that packet of cigarette, then the packet should contain a statutory warning saying that smoking is injurious to health, or cigarette smoking is injurious to health. Also, when you have these advertisement for baby food, okay, supplements, baby food, there must necessary inform to the potential buyer that the mother's milk is the best. So they can sell their product, they have to sell their product, but it should have something written there that says mother's milk is the best. So all these are the regulations which are required to follow by the business enterprises, that is by the advertisers. So it should be within the rules, regulations framed by the government administrative orders or court judgment, or by some enactment of act rules or decisions taken by the various committees and agencies. So this is legal environment. So these acts, these decisions taken, these rules, regulations will have an indirect effect on the sale of the products, sale of the alcoholic drinks, beverages. I told, there is no advertisement itself, it is prohibited. Cigarette, you have to have a statutory warning given, cigarette smoking is injurious to health. Also, the baby food advertiser, they have to give an information saying that mother's milk is the best. So all these have to be followed by the advertisers. So that is regarding the legal environment, how it is affecting, which is outside the control of the business enterprise and affecting the business performance. So in the dimensions of business environment is a practical oriented question I told, or sometimes may be asked for 4 marks, 2 environment may be asked. So in the economic environment, you had all these economic factors which are affecting. Once again, just brushing up, those are the interest rates, inflation rates, the disposable person income, the stock indices, value of rupee. These are the elements there. Then you have the social environment, where you have the social values, the social trends, the social expectations, which include these social factors, which include all this, which have an indirect effect. Technology, the advancement, the new ways, methods, techniques used by the business enterprises to advertise using their CD-ROM, the computerized information kiosk, and the each business enterprises, maybe the business enterprises or the not-for-profit organizations, even they use their own websites for promoting their products and services. Also, you have in the field of engineering and scientific field, you have the robotics, the biotechnology, the shift from the using of fountain pen to the ballpoint pen, typewriters to computers, and the locomotive engines to the diesel engines. All these changes took place in technological environment improvement. Then you have the political environment, how it is affecting. Political stability builds confidence. Political instability shakes the confidence. They will not think of, if there is political stability, then you can predict the business activities. If it is, on the other hand, if it is instability, there will be uncertainty in business activities. Then the legal environment, which includes legislations passed by the government, administrative orders issued by government authorities, or maybe court judgments, decisions taken by various commissions, agencies. So these will either will help the business enterprises to work within the within the framework, the rules, regulation, follow that strictly and carry on their business activities. Maybe in terms of the advertising their product, they have to follow. So all the rules and regulations have to be abided by the business enterprises. Next concept is economic environment in India. We have studied the economic environment in India. The economy, it consists of, the economic environment in India consists of various macro factors, or it consists of macro level factors which are related to the means of production and distribution of wealth, which have an impact on business and industry. So the economic environment in India consists of various macro level factors, macro factors or macro level factors related to the means of production and distribution of wealth, which have an impact on business and industry. These include the stage of economic development. The economic development, different stages. Earlier it might have been the traditional stage, or the traditional society, where main importance was given to agriculture, not much of using of sophisticated technology, traditionally produced at home, products produced at home. Then it went on to have next, we call it as a precondition stage or takeoff stage, where a little of technology was used, production was carried on through using technology. Then it went up to the next stage, where manufacturing actually took place. So this economy has developed through different stages. Traditional society we had, later on takeoff stage, or progress in the technology had taken place, some development has taken place. So economic environment includes stages of economic development. Economic structure. Indian economy, it is in the form of a mixed economy. What does it mean? Which recognize the role of both public as well as private sector. Indian economy is a mixed economy which recognize the role of both public as well as private sector. So that is again included in the economic environment. Economic environment, the economic structure where it has a mixed economy, where we have the role of both public and private sectors. Then the economic policies. The economic policies, what are the economic policies of the government? It includes the industrial policies, the monetary policies and the fiscal policies. Monetary policies, what are the monetary policies? It is the central bank activities, policies, the central bank activities regarding the monetary policies. Then you have the fiscal policies, the government adjustments, the spending of the money, how the government is using the money. The monetary policy may be the central bank activities, and the fiscal policy is relating to the government, the taxation and the spending of the amount. So all this comes under the economic policies. Industrial policies, monetary policies with the central bank activities relating to the money, related to the money. Fiscal policies relating to the government taxation and spending of that. So all that is in the economic policies. The economic planning, we have heard of 5-year plan, started in the year 1951. You had up till the recent 12 later on. So each 5-year plan had importance. Initially it was agriculture, then it was industry, then it was garibi hatao, then it was again giving technology importance, then it was again secured economic rapid development. So each economic plan had an important an aim. Okay, so that comes under economic planning. Economic planning as such, the 5-year plans, the annual budgets, the budgets, they are allocating a lump sum to different portfolios so that they can carry on their activities smoothly. So economic planning, which includes 5-year plans, the annual budgets, etc. Also the economic indices include the national income, distribution of income rate and growth of GNP, per capita income, disposable personal income. We all had this in the economic environment. So these are included in the economic indices. The economic indices like the national income, per capita income, you have the disposable personal income, DPI, rate of savings and investment, the value of exports and imports, the balance of payments and so on. So all these are included in economic indices. Then finally, you have the infrastructural factors such as the financial institutions and banks. Infrastructural factors, the financial institutions and the banks, transport and communication facilities, etc. Okay, so all these are related, or they are included in the as the macro factors. So the economic environment in India consists of various macro level factors which include all these. The stage of economic development, you have to just mention that, not a detailed concept is there. Economic structure, where you have a mixed economy. Economic policies, industrial, monetary and fiscal policies. Economic planning, 5-year planning, annual budgeting. Economic indices, per capita income, you have the national income, GNP and the DPI, disposable person income, the savings, rate of savings, investments and also the value of exports, imports, balance of payments, etc. Then you have the infrastructural factors, which includes financial institutions and banks, transport and communication. Okay, that is just a small concept, what is the economic environment in India. So now we will look into some economic problems. What were the economic problems of India at the time of independence? Having known the economic environment in India, which consists of these macro level factors, now we'll have a look on the economic problems of India at the time of independence. So at the time of independence, the economy mainly was agricultural in nature. Always said, what is the main occupation of India? That is agriculture. Agriculture and rural in character. There was no urbanization, it was rural, villages we say. So the economy was mainly agricultural and rural in character. About 70% of the working population were employed in agriculture, main occupation agriculture. About 70% of the total working population of the country India were employed in agriculture. And rural in nature, 85% of the people lived in villages. Because of it, it is given there the economy is rural in nature. Economy, agriculture, because 70% employed in agriculture. Rural in character, why? Because 85% of the population lived in villages. Production was carried on using irrational. There were no proper methods used, irrational. There were no reason or technology for using such a reason, a plan for using such a method, irrationally used. Irrational, low productivity technology. So production was carried on at home, sometimes using irrational methods, using low productivity technology. Initially it was, there was no much of sophisticated machineries, technologies. So their production was carried on using irrational low productivity technology. Okay, we are not able to get standardized good quality products, but main concern was what? Agriculture. So their industry business was not that much improvement or not taken place. There was no development. Communicable diseases were widespread. Communicable diseases, contagious diseases were widespread. Because of this, the mortality rates, death rate were high. There were no much vaccine medicines, maybe then the malaria, cholera, all these communicable contagious diseases were widespread and mortality rates were high, death rate was high. There was no good public health. Public health was not given much concern, no good public health. So all these were the economic problems at the time, which prevailed at the time of independence. So it is, economy was mainly agriculture and rural in character or nature. 70% of the working population, since it is agriculture, they were employed in agriculture, and 85% rural, they lived in villages. Production was carried on using irrational low productivity technology. We are not able to get standardized good quality products, no much of development, no transfer of sophisticated technologies. Communicable diseases were widespread, contagious diseases, hence the mortality rate, death rates were high, there were no good public health. Now, some government took up some measures for the development. What were the objectives? So there were, we come to the objectives of India's development plan to overcome these problems. Some measures were taken up by the government to solve these economic problems. They took several steps, including control by the state of certain industries, central planning, and reduce the importance of private sectors. So here they had to solve these problems, economic problems. So the government took up several steps. What were the steps taken and what was the main objective of this? So the objectives of India's development plans, the steps taken by the Indian government, what are those? Initiate rapid economic growth. You have to accelerate, take the step to speed up the economic growth. How? By raising the standard of living. In order to raise the standard of living, you have to reduce unemployment, give employment, employment opportunities increase. So raise the standard of living, reduce unemployment and poverty. So when there is employment, automatically poverty will reduce and there will be increased standard, standard of living will be increased, automatically it will be raised. So that is one of the objective, initiate rapid economic growth through raising the standard of living, reducing the unemployment and poverty. Become self-reliant. become self-reliant, don't depend on any. So you have to become self-reliant by setting up a strong base, a strong industrial base. So not only agriculture was given much importance, industry was given importance. So here there was the economy had to become self-reliant by setting up a strong industrial base where importance was given to heavy and basic industries. So in order to become self-reliant, you have to build a strong base. Building strong base, giving importance to heavy and basic industries. Also, reduce inequalities of income and wealth. So the role of the private sectors, importance of private sectors were reduced here. Why? Because there was inequality. The rich people became richer. So reduce inequalities of income and wealth. Also, adopt a socialistic pattern of development based on equality and prevent exploitation of man by man. Adopting a socialistic pattern of development means you had to see the social gain, not the private gain. So importance was given to social gain, the economy's gain. Private sector's importance was reduced. So that is adopt a socialistic pattern of development where importance was given to society's gain, social gain, not private gain, and which was based on equality and prevent the exploitation of man by man, by the rich people. The poor were exploited by the rich, so there was prevention of that. So these were the main objectives of the steps taken by the government in order to solve these economic problems. So this is regarding the economic problem and regarding the objectives or the steps taken by the government to solve this economic problem. Next we come to the economic, as a part of the economic reforms, the government of India in July 1991 brought about some features, changes took place. So as a part of economic reforms, the government of India announced a new industrial policy, in the year 1991, July 1991. So that is the new industrial policy which brought about a drastic change in the Indian economy. So what was those? The broad features of the new industrial policy. Broad features of new industrial policy. That is announced in the year 1991, July 1991. Okay, this was the government reduced the number of industries under compulsory licensing to 6. Okay, one of the main feature, the government reduced the compulsory licensing reduce the number of industries where the compulsory licensing was reduced under compulsory licensing to 6. Okay, so that was the one of the important feature. The government reduced the number of industries under compulsory licensing to 6. Earlier it was Most of the industries were under public sector. Now it is reduced only to 6. Some strategic important industries were only reserved to the public sector. Now in the year 2019, it is reduced only to 2, the atomic energy industry and the railway industry. Only those, they are reduced to 2. 6 it was, then it became to 5, then it came up to 2. So atomic energy, strategic importance, that is given, it is still reserved under public sector, and the railways. Okay. Then many of the industries reserved for the public sector under the earlier policy were de-reserved. Industries under public sectors which were reserved were now de-reserved. That means they were given to the hands of the private sectors. So they were de-reserved. The role of public sector was limited only to 4 industries of strategic importance. Same here, it was 6 industries. The role of public sector was given to only 4 industries of strategic importance. So their role slowly became less importance. Licensing was only for the 6 industries, compulsory licensing. Then many industries which were reserved under public sector slowly became de-reserved. That means only the role of public sector was limited only to 4 industries of strategic importance. Next, disinvestment was carried on. Disinvestment was carried on. In case of many public sector enterprises, it is carried on again. Public sector enterprises. What is disinvestment? The public sectors importance reduced. So this government began to sell its assets, to sell its stake. So the government diluted their ownership. Okay, their ownership was, which was beyond 51%, it was reduced. They sold their assets, they sold their stake. So there was disinvestment which was carried on in case of many public sector industrial enterprises. Also, policy towards foreign capital was liberalized. Policy towards foreign capital was liberalized. So there was more of foreign participation. There was foreign direct investment, what we call it as FDI, foreign direct investment. It is an investment in the form of controlling the ownership in business of one country by the entity based in some other country. So this gave way for FDI, that is foreign direct investment. Okay, that is investment in form of controlling the ownership in the business of one country by the entity based in some other country, so you have having the control over the ownership. You are based in some other country, but you have a control over the ownership of the country. That is through foreign direct investment. So it was permitted. Why? Because policy towards foreign capital was liberalized. There was share of foreign equity participation increased, which gave way to liberalization. FDI was permitted. Also, automatic permission was granted for technology agreement with foreign companies. Automatic permission was granted for technology agreements. Okay, technology agreements with the foreign country. So no much of restrictions, no much of rules. So easily permission was granted for technology agreements with foreign companies. FIPB, Foreign Investment Promotion Board, was set up. There was something called as FIPB, that is Foreign Investment Promotion Board. Okay, this was mainly to channelize and encourage the foreign investment, to promote foreign investment in India. So there was a board which was set up, Foreign Investment Promotion Board, which was set up mainly with the intention, aim of channelizing and promoting foreign investment in India. So foreign investment is investment in the domestic companies and assets by a foreign investor. Foreign direct investment is having a control and ownership of one company in some other company, where the entity based in some other company. Foreign investment is investment in domestic companies' assets by a foreign investor. So this was mainly Foreign Investment Promotion Board was mainly to channelize and promote foreign investment in India. Okay. These were some of the steps taken to remove the obstacle in growth and expansion of the industry units of large industrial houses. So these were the reasons, or with these measures, India, the country, the total industrial policy has sought to liberate industry, liberalization, industry from the shackles of licensing. Compulsory licensing was reduced to only 6 industry. So there was liberalization, remove the business enterprises from the difficulties or the shackles of the licensing, and the role of public sector here. Disinvestment was carried out, public sector assets, their stake was sold, so they were given to the hands of the private sector. So the role of public sector was reduced, it is called as privatization. And there was encouragement of foreign private participation in India for the industrial development. That was economy open, that is called as globalization. So these new industrial policy gave way to the three concepts, which is called as LPG. It's not liquefied purified gas. It is liberalization, privatization, and globalization. So all these give way to liberalization. The economy, the industries were liberalized from the shackles of the licensing raj. Then it was privatization, role of the public sector reduced. Then globalization. So what is liberalization? The economic reforms that were introduced aimed at liberalizing the Indian business and industry from the shackles of unnecessary controls and restrictions. So liberalization refers to the process of eliminating unnecessary, unnecessary controls and restrictions. Okay. Eliminating unnecessary controls and restrictions which gave way to smooth functioning of their business and industry or their business enterprises. So liberalization, the main economic reform, the new industrial policy which was introduced, the economic reforms which are introduced aimed at liberalizing the Indian business and industry from all unnecessary controls and restrictions. So it is the process of eliminating, removing unnecessary controls and restrictions which gave way to smooth functioning of the business enterprises. They signaled the end of license permit quota raj. So this signaled the end of license permit quota raj. This came to an end, or it signaled, it says, they signaled the end of license permit quota raj. That means there was no requirement of much of licensing, only strategic importance industry in the public sector required. They had to go as per the rules and regulations. Restrictions were imposed on those, not on the other industries. Liberalization of Indian industry had taken place in these aspects. What was those? Abolishing industrial license requirement in most of the industries. So most of the industries, there was no need of licensing. Licensing permit quota raj, it was an end through liberalization. So abolishing licensing requirements in most of the industries except a short list. Now I told it is shortlisted to, it was 6, now recent it is 2, only atomic energy and the railways need to be licensed, grant licensed. Then freedom in deciding the scale of business activities. The business enterprises had the freedom to decide the scale of business activity, whether it is large scale, medium, small, or whether they want to expand the business, whether they want to contract, whether expansion or contraction of the business. It was the freedom was given to the owners, the entrepreneurs of the business enterprises. Removal of restrictions on the movement of the goods. There was no much of restrictions on the movement of the goods and services. They could freely move. Movement of goods and services was free without much of restrictions. And freedom in fixing the prices of goods and services. There was freedom given to fix the prices of the goods and services. Also, there was reduction in tax rate by lifting unnecessary controls over the economy. So these were some of the features of liberalization, you can say. Also, simplifying the import and export procedure. You have studied in your first year, you have the export-import lengthy procedure. So there was simplification of that. So there could be export promotion, more of export, simplifying the procedure of import and export, and also simplifying, making it easy to attract foreign capital and technology. Simplifying the procedure involved in foreign capital investment and technology to India in order to attract foreign capital and technology. So these were the features of liberalization, we can say. So what is liberalization? Liberalization is the process of eliminating unnecessary controls and restrictions. They signaled the end of license permit quota raj. This liberalization included abolishing licensing requirement in most